everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, as Jesus our Savior.
We're just so thankful that you are mighty to save and you take great delight in us and you quiet us with your love and you rejoice over us with singing, Lord. And we ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on us and you would pour down every blessing that you have in store for everyone here, Lord, and for those that aren't. We thank you and we praise you and we look and receive an expectation. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Good morning. Are we ready to worship God in Scripture? Yes. Hallelujah. Okay, I've been challenged to welcome you with a Scottish accent. So I take on the challenge a wee bit of time. And I tell you, if you're new here, All right, we want to welcome you to Scotland's Christian Church, formerly known as Scottsdale Christian Church. That's Bryson's joke back there. I can't take credit for that. Hey, dude, we do want to welcome you. If you are new here today, we have a lot of fun here, as you're going to see in a minute, as we look back. But we are going forward with some great things we're going to talk about. This is the state of the church today, and it's exciting. But what's exciting is knowing that if you're here with us and you're new today, it is beautiful to worship God with you. We want to welcome you to Scottsdale Christian Church. Yeah. So, if you are new, you won't really know what happened last year, but for all of us that have enjoyed an incredible year, we're going to take a look back. So, enjoy.
Dude, how do you end on that song? I've got to preach after that. Goodness. Oh, my goodness. Man, what a year. What a year. It's always amazing to me to look back at those things because some of those things seem like they happened 10 years ago, not just in this last year. A lot of stuff has happened. A lot of people have come, and a lot of people have had lives change. And that's why we're here as a church. We're here to bring people closer in a relationship with God, to help people grow in their faith. And this morning, we're going to be looking somewhat at the past, but also looking now to the future and what God has in store for us. And so this morning, we're going to be looking at Jesus and his disciples and how some of their stories relate to us. And so if you have a Bible this morning, turn to Luke chapter 9. If you don't have a Bible, there should be one of the chairs in front of you. It's page 733. You can find it on your phone or tablet pretty easily. Or if you have your own Bible, Luke is kind of toward the end of the Bible, after the books of Matthew, Mark, and then Luke. Luke chapter 9, Jesus has been ministering. He's been teaching and preaching and doing all those things. He's been doing that for probably about 18 months, 2 years, somewhere in there. And then he is meeting with his 12 disciples, and we're going to see what happens next, and again, how it relates to us today. Luke chapter 9, I'll start reading with verse 1. When Jesus had called the 12 together, he gave them power and authority to drive out all demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. He told them, take nothing for the journey. No staff, no bag, no bread, no money, no extra tunic. Whatever house you enter, stay there until you leave that town. If people do not welcome you, shake the dust off your feet when you leave their town as a testimony against them. So they set out and went from village to village, preaching the gospel and healing people everywhere. And then in verse 10, when the apostles returned, they reported to Jesus what they had done. Then he took them with him, and they withdrew by themselves to a town called Bethsaida. So as we're looking through here, the disciples, the word disciple means to be a learner. Or to be a follower. That's just what the word means. Those of you who have had some training in education know that for someone to truly learn something, you've got to get beyond just the listening, and you have to get involved in being involved in it, whatever it is. That's just a stage that happens where people truly own whatever it is that you're trying to teach them. And so Jesus did the same thing with his disciples. At times they watched him do ministry. And then he had them participate with him. And then at this stage, Jesus sent them out to do the stuff that they had been watching him do. And so Jesus took his 12 disciples and said, okay, guys, here's what's going to happen. I'm going to send you out in twos. You're going to minister. You're going to do the stuff you've seen me doing. And this is something that Jesus was doing to train them, to prepare them for when he was gone. And so there are three things that we're going to look at this morning about those disciples and then us as well. First of all, disciples receive an assignment. Disciples receive an assignment. For the 12, Jesus gave them a task. It says that he said he gave them power to drive out demons. He gave them power to cure diseases. He told them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. And so he gave them an assignment. That's what you're supposed to do. When you go to these villages, that's what I want you to do at these places. But Jesus gave them a companion. He didn't make them do it on their own. The book of Mark says that Jesus sent them out in twos. So they paired up as they went to the villages and preached. Jesus also gave them power and authority. basically he deputized him and said, okay, I may be the sheriff, but you're the deputies. You guys go put this stuff into action. And then Jesus gave them resources, but very little. He said, if you were following along there, he said, don't take anything with you, okay? Don't take a staff. A staff was kind of like a walking stick, which was also used kind of as a weapon. He said, don't take a bag. And the bag he's referring there to could either just kind of be a generic bag or it could be a begging bag. Like if you stood on the corner and were asking for money and stuff like that, it would be a bag to put stuff in. He said, don't take anything like that. Don't take any extra food. Don't take any extra money. Don't take extra clothes. Because what you are getting ready to do is urgent. I don't want you going home and packing. I don't want you taking a bunch of stuff. I just need you to get out and I need you to do it. And what's going to happen is when you get to these villages, you're going to show up and someone's going to welcome you into their house. And you stay at their house as long as they'll have you. Okay? And when they're done, then go on to the next village. So that was the resources. Jesus said, yeah, you're going to have me, the Spirit with you. But as far as physical stuff, you're not going to have much. Get out there and get to work. It was a short mission and one they needed to get to right away. Well, you know what? Today for us, as a church, we have the same assignment that they were given. In Matthew chapter 28, in some of his last words to his followers, Jesus says this, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. We have the same assignment that the disciples were given. Our job as a church is to go and reach people for Jesus Christ, to teach them about him, to bring them into a relationship with him, and then to help them grow in their faith. And you know what? Just like the disciples, we have companions. The disciples were sent out in twos, but we have this whole church. You look around, these are the people that are supposed to be fulfilling this task with us. We as a church body have all these people and others that aren't here this morning to rely on, to work with, to reach this part of the country, this part of this town for Jesus Christ. And just like the disciples, we have power. Jesus said, I'll be with you to the very end of the age. Jesus says he will be with us. And as followers of Christ today, we have the Holy Spirit in us. And we have resources. We have a few more resources than the disciples did when they went out. All right? We've got a building. Okay? That's kind of nice. It's a building we can kind of walk into, be proud of. When people come in here during the week, it's amazing to see their reaction. Because they're expecting a church building, and then they come in here and they're like, well, this is a little different. You've got garage doors. And we're like, well, yeah, they're kind of cool. We like them, you know? And so their first reaction to the place is very positive. We're located in the heart of one of the fastest growing communities in the country. I mean, when you look at South Scottsdale, south of Chaparral, this little sliver of land in Scottsdale, the amount of housing that's going up in South Scottsdale, the amount of retail that's being redone, it's one of the biggest growing communities in the country. And we are right in the middle of it. During the week, if you come to this building, you'll feel the ground shake, okay? Literally ground shaking because of all the destruction that's happening county corner from us and then just right over there as they're getting rid of old stuff to put new stuff in. I mean, I don't know if things are falling over or they're dropping something heavy, but the whole building just kind of shakes at times because we're in a great place. We're in a place where a lot of people are moving in from our town. People that are moving here for jobs and they're living close to here. And when people are moving to a new place, guess what? They're looking to start over. They're looking for new friends. They're looking for a church home where they can be involved and they can worship God. And we are in the middle of that. The same assignment the disciples have, we have. So the disciples, they were given an assignment. Go out and preach the word. Preach the kingdom of God. And we have that same assignment today. The second thing we learn from this is that disciples follow instructions. To be a learner means that at some point you're following this teacher. And when this teacher gives instructions, that's kind of what you do. In verse 6, there in chapter 9, it says, so they set out, went from village to village, preaching the gospel and healing people everywhere. You know what the disciples didn't do? They didn't have a committee meeting. You know, the 12 of them didn't get together and said, well, Jesus said this. What do you think we should do? They said, Jesus said it. Okay, go. Let's go. Let's go do these things. They were just obedient. And if you look at a map of Israel, toward the top, you can see the Dead Sea, which is there on the bottom, just up and to the left of that a little bit. That's kind of the area that they were going to. They just went from village to village. They were going to the Israelites, and they were preaching the gospel, proclaiming the good news. And the good news was simply this: the God that made this universe has come to earth, and he's establishing a kingdom so that everyone can be a part of that. So when you die, you get to go to heaven, but right here, right now, you get to be in a relationship with the God of the universe. And they were going out and preaching that. As a church, for those of you that don't know the history, you saw it there just a second ago on the video. As a church, we've set out. We moved about 2 miles to this new location. And we have our village. Basically, we're trying to reach South Scottsdale. The zip codes of 85257, 85251, that's where we're trying to spend most of our time, our energy, and our resources. And we have been preaching the gospel since we've been here. We've done an event every month. That's been kind of a fun event. It's been an event that reaches out into the community so that people from this area will know that we're not just about being here on Sunday morning. We're about being involved in every aspect of our community. It's been a lot of work to put all those events on. It's taken a lot of time and a lot of energy, you know. But beyond that, we've been doing other things. One of the pictures you saw was we're a part of the Chamber of Commerce. And so the mayor and other people were here from the chamber to do a ribbon cutting event. Some of you saw last week, we had an article in the Arizona Central newspaper, and it was a really cool article about us. If you haven't seen it, it's out on the wall. It's on the magnetic wall out there, so you can look at that article and see. You know, beyond that, people have been having conversations. People have been inviting people to come to church. And while we don't have the same authority that the disciples did to instantly heal diseases, we have seen lives healed. We've seen marriages brought back together. We've seen addictions overcome. We've seen lives transformed, all through the power of the name of Jesus Christ. And as a church, that's what we have to offer. I talked about it a little bit last week. You know, there are a lot of different people in the world that try to help people, but there's only one organization in the world that's proclaiming Jesus Christ, and that's the church. And we do a lot of good things, and we try and help out a lot of people, and we don't do it so that we get the credit for it. We don't want our names promoted. We want to promote the name of Jesus Christ. And that's why we're here following his instructions, doing the stuff that he tells us to do. As individuals, that's our call. That's our responsibility. That's what Jesus wants us to do. In John chapter 14, Jesus says this: whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. Whoever has my commands and obeys them, he's the one that loves me. How do you know if you love Jesus Christ? He says, if you follow my commands, if you do the things I tell you to do, that's how you know that you love me. You know, as an individual, there are times when I do that well. I told you, a few weeks ago that I'm a part of the Chamber of Commerce, a group that meets every Monday morning, and there's about 20 business owners in there. And one of the things I did, I got up and did a presentation about the church and about Jesus Christ in a business meeting with all these people. For me, the Chamber of Commerce is one of the few places I have contact with non-Christians, okay? When I show up here in church, people kind of know where I stand on issues, okay? But to be outside of here, I have to put myself in positions to interact with non-Christians. That's just a part of what I have to do. And so at that chamber meeting, you know, I presented. Here's who Jesus Christ is. And I feel like, you know, I did a pretty good job with that. But there are other times that I'm out there and I mess up. I mess up. I was meeting with an insurance lady recently, just last week, and just redoing car and home insurance, stuff like that. And as I'm talking, she finds out I'm a pastor, and so we're having a conversation, and she starts talking about Jesus. It's probably, and you could kind of tell she's not used to talking about Jesus at all, and she's doing it kind of to be nice to me and that type of thing. And I was, honestly, I was more concerned about getting my insurance done than I was about having the conversation. And I blew it. I blew it. There was a time there that I could have turned the conversation to a spiritual thing, got more involved in her life, and I didn't do a good job. You know, as disciples, Jesus has given us all instructions to preach the gospel. And I think that on a regular basis, if we are seeking God, He's going to provide opportunities for us to talk to other people about Christ, to make a difference in people's lives for Jesus Christ. And when those opportunities come up, we've got to take advantage of them. You know, I do. I feel bad because I miss that. But I ask God, you know, God, I'm sorry. But please keep giving me opportunities. Please keep giving me chances that I can obey you and follow the instructions that you've given. See, because disciples receive an assignment. It's an assignment that goes beyond Sunday morning. It's an assignment for our everyday lives. And disciples, followers of Christ, are ones who follow God's instructions. And the third part is this. The disciples give a report. In verse 10, see what happened? When the apostles returned, they reported to Jesus what they had done. When the apostles return. And the interesting thing is here is they're called disciples. Jesus called his 12 disciples to him, and he sent them out. When they got back, he changes them their title to apostles. They went from being a disciple, from a learner, to an apostle. An apostle means one who is sent out, one who is a messenger. And they got a title change. And so when they got back, they reported to Jesus what they'd done. And the word report there in the Bible means they provided detailed information in a systematic manner of what had happened. And so Jesus said, hey, you guys have been doing a lot of work. Let's go spend some time by ourselves. Here at this church, we try and give a report every year about where we stand as a church. Jesus has said, you need to do these things. So the response is, okay, here's what we've been trying to do. And so there are things that, just so you know what's happening, our attendance since we moved to this building, we've averaged 135 people a week. Now, why do we take attendance? Why is that something that we follow and track? We do that because attendance at church on Sunday morning is a reflection of our desire to worship God and His priority in our life. You know, the difference between when I go to chamber meetings and they talk about businesses and how to grow business and stuff like that, one of the very first questions they ask is, well, who's your competition? You know, if you're Lowe's, your competition is Home Depot, okay? If you're Fry's, your competition is Bash's. Bash's isn't here, is it? Yeah, it is. Okay, I'm confused. I've been talking to some friends from Ohio, and there's different grocery stores there, and everything's a mess. Bash's is here. I see a lot of nods. All right. Gosh, it's so awful. As a church, our competition is not the church down the road. That's not what it is, because we've got the same goal. As a church, our competition is the grocery store, whichever one may be here. Okay? As a church, our competition is the parks. As a church, our competition is the television. As a church, our competition is the bed, you know? Because that's always amazing. Since I've been in ministry, it's always blown me away. Because our service started at 9:30. And one of the things I always hear from people is, well, that's my Sunday, I would go to church, but it's my only day to sleep in. And I'm like, seriously? You're allowed to get to work at 9:30 during the week? That's amazing to me. And they're like, well, no, I don't go to work at 9:30. Well, what time do you go to work? You know, anywhere. They have to be there at 9 or 8 or whatever time. And so I'm like, dude, you get to sleep in at least an extra half hour. At least an extra half hour to make it to church. So don't ever tell me that you miss church because it's your only day to sleep in, okay? That's not in fault. You have to make up some better excuse than that. But our attendance, we track that because it's a reflection of what our priorities are. It's a reflection of, you know what? I say that I follow God, but if I don't make time to worship him, then something's off. And so that's one of the numbers that we track. Another number that we track is our giving. Our giving is right about $4,400 a week. That's what it's been the average for this year. On the one hand, let me go back. The reason we track giving is it's a measure of our trust in God. Because really what giving the first 10% of your income is, it's a reflection of, if I give the first 10% of my income, then I've got to trust God with the other 90%. With the bills that I have and everything that's going on, I've got to trust him. If I don't trust him, I'm not going to give. If I do trust him, I'm going to give, not knowing how these things are going to get taken care of. And so giving is a reflection of our trust in him. Our weekly need is about $6,500 a week. And that includes everything. That includes the staff. It includes utilities. It includes rent. That's about what we need. Now, when we moved, what we did is when we sold our building, we set aside rent for 3 years. And that's all cool. But what's going to happen at the end of 3 years, we need to make sure that we have rent for something. We need to have a place to meet. And so our need is about $6,500 a week, including a facility. Right now, the giving is about $4,400. I know that this is one of the big issues that people have, is trusting God with their finances. I'm not saying this to brag, but I just want to let you guys know that the things that I'm asking you to do, because they're in the Bible, not because it's my preference, the stuff that's in the Bible I'm asking you to do is stuff that I do. You know, I understand what it's like. We give 14% of our income. We tithe just at the very beginning. I'm not saying that to brag. I'm just saying that's where we are, because we said, well, if this is the basic minimum, we want to increase that over the years. And I'll tell you what, God is taking care of our family. I know what it's like to have a car payment. I know what it's like to put two kids through braces at the same time. That's awful. I know what it's like. And the result is kind of good, but I know what it's like to put a kid through college. It's expensive stuff. But I'll tell you what, as a family, we have never gone without. We've never gone hungry. We've been married for 20-some years, and we've always given to God first. And God has always taken care of our needs. There have been some wants that we haven't taken, you know, we haven't gotten everything that we wanted. But I'll tell you what, we haven't missed out as a family. I was going through a bunch of pictures recently, looking at all the stuff that we've done over the years. Oh my goodness. We have had opportunity to do a lot of fabulous things. And that's after, or maybe even because, we gave to God first. And I know it's a scary, big change, but it's one that you really need to get with God, and you guys need to get straightened out on that. Another number that we track is the number of adults in groups. 30% of our adults go to a group. That's either a small group that meets during the week, a Bible study that meets here at the church on Wednesday, about 37% of our people. The reason we track that is because coming to Sunday morning is a great thing. It's a great way to worship God, but it's not a great place to make friends. And so our groups replace, number one, where we get deeper into God's word, and number two, we connect with other people in the church. And so it's a reflection of how many people are wanting to do that in the church. And so that's one of the reasons we track that number. 37%, that's about average as far as churches go. Big churches, small churches, about 37, you know, it's about 35 to 40, somewhere in there. We're kind of average in that. And being average is good. If you want to be the worst of the best or the best of the worst, average is a great place to be. And so that's kind of where we are. Baptisms. We track this number because how are we doing at bringing people into a relationship with Jesus Christ? We had 8 baptisms this last year. For a church our size, that's great. That's great. Our goal is obviously South Scottsdale. Anyone that doesn't know Jesus Christ, that's our goal. So how do we know if we've grown too big or grown enough? When everybody in South Scottsdale knows about Jesus Christ and has had a chance to get into a relationship with him, then we can call it a day. Okay? So that's the goal. First-time guests. We track first-time guests. We've had 243 first-time guests that have come to our church. And we track that number because how good a job are we doing at attracting people? How good a job are we doing at getting people here? I'll tell you right up, most people come by this church building either because of the website or because of just driving by. That's how most people find our church. In one sense, that's good. In another sense, it's not so good. Because the number one reason that people should come to a church is because a friend or a family member invited them. Because those are the people that tend to stick longer, is when we invite people to church. I know this is tough at times. For me, the Chamber of Commerce is the number one place that I use to invite people to church here. I started that in April. To the building, I've had 8 people come to the building. I've had another 3 people come to either a service or one of our events. Beyond that, I've gone to local businesses and given out information about the church and stuff like that. Right now, I've had 3 people come to an event or a service. I'm going to keep trying. It's a slow process for me because I'm the pastor and I'm the big scary guy. And I know people's reaction to that. And so it takes a while to build those relationships and get involved in people's lives where they're going to open up. Okay. But it's something that I keep trying at. It's as a church, that's something that we continually do. We want people to come here. We believe that we've got a great worship service. We believe that every week at this church, you're going to get the Word of God. You didn't come to hear me talk. You came to hear what God had to say through His Word. We believe that as a church, we're a friendly church. We have good stuff for kids, for teens. We believe those things about our church. And we want people to come and experience finding God at this place. We're going to have to give an account of the things that we've done. When the disciples came back and reported to Jesus, they had to give an account of what they had done with what he'd given them. Beyond that, Romans chapter 14 says the same thing to us. It says, so then each of us will give an account of himself to God. Each one of us is going to give an account to God. Hey, God, here's what you gave me. Now, here's what I did with it. Now, when it talks about giving an account to God, when it's talking about that, if you're a follower of Jesus, if you've already made him the Lord of your life, if you've already been baptized into him, giving an account of God is not at the end of your life where you stand up in front of the pearly gates, standing on a cloud, waiting in line for St. Peter to let you in. Okay? If you're already a follower of Jesus Christ, it's not a question of whether or not you get in. That's already been decided. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you don't stand and give an account to God to say, so then he'll let you into heaven or kick you out. That's not what it is. That's already been decided when you chose to let Jesus Christ be the Lord of your life. You're in. But then he's going to say, what'd you do with the life that I gave you? And he's going to say, did you stand up for me? Did you minister to other people in my name? That's what he's going to ask us about. You know, I read this story about in February of 2015, Darrell Waltrip. He was a Hall of Fame NASCAR driver. He was at the National Prayer Breakfast here in the United States. And as he got up there, he was in front of the dignitaries of like 160 countries. And he got up and said, man, I used to think I was a pretty good person. But he said this. He said, but good people go to hell without Christ. He said, God changed my life from being a man that struggled with pride and alcoholism to a person who's now humble and lives for Christ and not for himself. He said this about himself. He said, people said I was brash, ruthless, pushy, cocky, conceited, aloof, boastful, arrogant, and just downright annoying. And those were the people that liked me. So when I became a follower of Jesus Christ, it made a difference, a change in my life. And he talked about that in front of all those people. Now, most of us are not going to have a chance to be in an audience in front of that type of a crowd, but we all have a chance to live out the assignment that Jesus Christ has given us. Our assignment is in South Scottsdale. It's in the neighborhoods that we live. It's in the places that we work. It's in the places that we go to during the week. That's the assignment that we've been given. And it may not ever get put up on YouTube, but God sees it. And he is the audience that we're living this out for. As the disciples, we're going to give a report of what we did with what we were given. And I want to be able to stand before God and say, God, gave him my all. And I want to hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. As a church, here's where we are. Just as a reminder, I want to remind you of this, that when we sold our building, that we had enough money for rent for 3 years. We said, as a church, we're going to have to grow. We're going to have to grow and reach people that are lost. We have to bring them in. And those people, we have to teach them and train them to give because we've only got money for 3 years. In 3 years, if things don't change, then we'll be done. Then we'll close the doors. And so I think there are a lot of people here this morning whose lives have been changed by the things that are going on, by the way that God's working through the people in this church. And I just do want to put this reminder out here. You know, there are a lot of people like you. If you remember what you were like before you knew Christ and what your life is like now, there's a lot of people around here that need the same opportunity that you had. They need to grow in their walk with God just like you. And church, we have a limited time to make that happen. I'm going to put this on the wall. This is our time to make a difference in South Scottsdale. It's just a simple calendar that lists the months until we run out of rent money. And so here is the check mark. We've already been through these months. So this is what we have left to make a difference. So what I'm going to do this morning is I'm just going to go ahead and put it on this wall over here so that you that are here this morning, you'll be able to see this. I'm not going to make a big deal of it. We'll just kind of, as we go along, we'll just mark off the different months. We know what the assignment is. We just got to get it done. One way or another. Okay? And so this is what God has called us to do. And so that little frame there is a reminder for us every week of the assignment that God's given us. The disciples, they went out for, I don't know, it doesn't say how long, weeks, a month or so. That tells you how long we have to get some stuff done in the name of God here in South Scottsdale. So every time you go by that, remember that. Pull this sermon up on YouTube. Watch it again, and you'll be reminded of the task that God has given us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you've trusted us. My goodness, you've trusted us with the most important task in the world. And God, we've seen lives change. We've seen people transform through the power of your Son. And God, I pray that you'll work in each one of us and you'll give us opportunities to stand up and to stand out for you. God, we love you. And we know there's a lot of people around here who desperately need to know your love in their lives. Pray that you help us to reach them for you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning. It's another time of our service where we will have communion. And it's a new year. And all new years, we do this thing called look back. And we did it this morning as a church. We do it in our own personal lives. And we always take a chance to look forward. What's going to happen to our future? When we look back at our past, we don't always see all of our plans fulfilled. We don't always see things turn out the way we hoped they would turn out. When we look to the future, we don't plan on those failures. We plan on success. But we don't always get that. Well, communion is a time where we reflect on what Jesus did and what he plans for our future. Those plans always work out. Those plans are always a success. So this morning in communion, I want us to look back and think about what Jesus did for us on the cross. He died for us. He took our place. Our sins have been covered through him. And we get an opportunity for a future in heaven just for believing, just for accepting that gift from on the cross. And what does that future look like? Well, John 14 tells us what Jesus says it looks like. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be with where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Well, this morning I was standing on my balcony when the sun was coming up and watching all the colors in the sky and watching them change. I thought, what does heaven look like? Because John tells us in Revelation he can't even describe it. This is the place that Jesus is preparing for us. So this morning for communion, when the servers passed the trays with the juice and the crackers, for all of us that believe that Jesus is our Savior, that he died for us, and that he's preparing a place for us for eternity, our future, please join us. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you so much for having Jesus in our past, where he died for us on the cross, for our present, where we get to accept that gift and believe in you and your Son and all that it stands for, and for giving us a future that can't be messed up because you have it planned. And we know your plans always come true because you are God. You are our God. You are the creator of the universe. You are the creator of us. And you want the best for us. And for that, you sent your Son, Jesus, to die for us. We thank you, and we praise you this morning for that. It's in your precious Son's name we pray. Amen.
I will pray, and then we'll be done. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for the love that you have for us, the way that you gave, the way that you sent your Son. And God, I thank you for the impact he has had in so many people's lives as they've been transformed to look more and more like him. And God, I pray that you'll help us, that you'll provide opportunities, and that we will have the courage and the boldness to take advantage of those this week. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Engage starts in 10 minutes.